Hello. Wherever you turn these days, marketers are trying to grab your attention long enough to make a lasting impression. And for good reason. You know, you could have the world's most amazing and useful product, but if you can't market it well, your dreams of success will never be realized. I'm Nelson Davis, executive producer of Making It. And today you'll meet entrepreneurs who've had to unlock the puzzles of marketing, sometimes by making some very expensive mistakes.
Making It, featuring inspiring personal stories of struggle, triumph, and success from America's small business communities.
Hello and welcome to Making It. I'm Lynette Romero.
And I'm Emmett Miller. Thanks for joining us. There are more media messages bombarding us now than ever before. So how do you get your business to stand out in the crowd? That was the question facing Alvin Chang and Bobby Burton, a Porterhouse bistro. Alvin had already found success at the helm of Taiwan's famous Wang steakhouses. But going up against steakhouses in Beverly Hills, California, woo, that was another matter entirely.
First, Alvin knew he had to find a partner who could help him break into the American market. He worked with PR companies and used good old-fashioned word of mouth to meet restaurant manager Bobby Burton. Alvin was certain that together, their restaurant could offer a high-quality dining experience. But they had to purchase a location and then get customers in the door. And that was easier said than done.
The partners started advertising in newspapers and on the radio about their special steak recipe, a 26-ounce porterhouse aged for a solid 26 days. And then they sent out a letter inviting people to come to try it for free. They expected this promotion would cost, oh, I don't know, maybe $200,000. Instead, it cost $500,000. And what's worse, it didn't work. Sure, customers came once, but it didn't keep them all coming back.
That's when Alvin realized that even though Americans and Taiwanese share different tastes when it comes to steak, they have the same desire for value. And as Ziomar Galindo reports, they had to devise a marketing plan that would work for their Porterhouse Bistro.
In Taiwan, people don't like meat with blood. Here in America, people don't like steak cooked well done. And the other thing is, I would say American people have more loyalty on the brand they love. So they just keep coming back. And also, having steak is one of their, like, habit.
After his success in Taiwan with the Wang Steakhouse, Alvin Chang came to the U.S. to search out the recipe for a successful American steakhouse.
I traveled the biggest 10 cities in the United States. At that moment, I just tried to realize what kind of a market, especially steak market in America, what it looks like, and how these people look like, and how can I compete with them.
When you found Peter Luger in New York, you found a restaurant model that you wanted to emulate. However, you realized that you had to go one step further with your business. What did you do?
So I'm thinking, how can I to get started? So I say, okay, let's go to ask my guest, my potential guest. So during my visit in different restaurants, I start to talk to people who sit next to me. And I invite them to come to my secret kitchen to test my steak. Because at that moment, I have my menu ready. In Taiwan, what we serve is a marinade short rib. But here, I bring that recipe and product. Nobody like it. Not nobody. 50%. 50% like it. And I say, come on. I cannot build a business on 50% customer satisfaction. So that's why I changed the product.
Alvin also conducted a nationwide search for someone to help him build his restaurant empire in the United States. Hence, his introduction to Bobby Burton.
Well, I started when I was 11 years old as a dishwasher. My mom was the controller of a restaurant. I had the opportunity that age, and I took it. I've been in this business ever since, and I've been every job from the dishwasher to an owner.
Alvin and Bobby opened Porterhouse Bistro in August of 2001. A month later, the attacks on 9/11 occurred and shattered their dreams for a grand beginning. They put their heads together and came up with an idea to give away free steak dinners.
The theory was is that we're going to be in this competitive market. So if we're going to do that, in order to make an impact, we need the first round of customers. So how are we going to go and get them? So we started thinking of all these different marketing ideas. And one of the things we thought is, you know what? Let's spend $500,000 and let's get all these people in here, try our steak, and if 20% of them like our steak, they'll come back and be regular customers. It didn't work out that way.
Bobby, what was the result?
One of the main results is that we ultimately figured out that nobody wants to pay for something that was once for free. But most people appreciate the discount, and they appreciate the quality of food that they got for that. But ultimately, we did. The theory that we had originally did work, because we kept about 20% of that clientele.
However, there was something else the partners did not account for: the hidden variable expense. The subsequent fees for staff support, linens, the breakage of dishes and glasses cost them an additional $300,000, destroying their whole plan. So it was back to the drawing board.
Why go with a price-fixed menu? It seems to me that you could make a great deal of money with an a la carte individual menu.
One of the philosophies we have is that we were sick and tired, to be quite honest, of going to restaurants and paying $80, $90 a head to get average food with average service. Because generally they all do the same thing, like Alvin said. There's the same piece of meat, and it's the same professional waiter. And, you know, at the end of the day, it becomes boring. So what we said is, how do we make this more fun, and how do we make it so that the customer will come back to us and create the relationship with us maybe two or three times a month, as opposed to once a year at any other restaurant. So what we did is we created the letter marketing program, and then we created the price that sat just below what the industry standard is for fine dining restaurants.
Porterhouse Bistro is able to offer their steaks at such a competitive price because they did their research. They met with the top 50 vendors in Los Angeles to get the best price for their meat. Alvin, given your 14 years of experience in the restaurant industry, what is the toughest part about running your company now?
The toughest part is because I'm a foreigner. So actually, it's hard for me to understand what people, they really want. So I have to keep asking, to keep understand what people really wanted. So in Taiwan, actually, it's easy. I know what people really want. And what I offer is what they really want, and they come.
What is the business's secret to success?
One of the things that Alvin and I do, we have very, very similar characters and very similar philosophies. And one of the things we always do is we constantly challenge ourselves, literally daily. And we know this is a competitive industry. We know this is a competitive market. We know that in Beverly Hills has some of the finest foods and professionals in the world. So if we're going to compete, we're going to have to do this, and we have to do it pretty efficiently.
You know, they talked about that, but that's the hardest thing, knowing what the customer wants.
Yeah. It's ever-changing, or it's always a challenge for them, I'm sure. Okay, Alvin and Bobby are taking the prefix menu to the next level, offering the same menu at even lower prices on weekdays. That's Monday through Thursday. Their next goal is to expand and introduce Porterhouse Bistro into other cities nationwide.
And even if Porterhouse Bistro becomes as well-known as Coca-Cola or Nike, it doesn't mean Alvin and Bobby should stop marketing. Just think about the top brand names you know today. You see billboards, television ads, new promotions every few months for these brand leaders. In today's Secret to Success, marketing consultant Bonnie Dean says that's vital no matter how big your business is.
In today's competitive business arena, it's vital that your name, your product, your service is in front of your client base every 3 to 4 months. Let's review some ways to do that. First would be a newsletter. Most computers today come loaded with software already designed to help you do a 1 to 2 page newsletter that can inform and educate your client base. Along the computer line, let's think about getting contact management programs like ACT, Goldmine, or Sharkware that'll help you. It assists you in keeping track of clients' birthdays, anniversaries, special events, interests, and hobbies, so that when you come across that article in the magazine on golf, quilting, or fishing, you can clip it, punch your computer, and find the client to send it to with a little personal note. Think about investing time in your community and getting involved in charitable events. Not only is it good for your community, but it gives you high visibility with movers and shakers in the business world, an opportunity to kind of rub shoulders with them in a non-salesy way. Remember, he who has a thing to sell and goes and whispers in a well is not as apt to get the dollar as she who climbs a tree and hollers. Go get 'em.
And if you'd like to learn more about Bonnie Dean's marketing tips, log on to her website. It's BonnieDean.com. And for more advice on achieving your business goals, visit our website, MakingItTV.com.
And coming up next, everyone told him it couldn't be done, but Doug Lopez used technology to revolutionize window sales. And because of his creative marketing approach, he started turning a profit in only 4 months. We'll have his story when we come back. Don't go away.
Capturing the excitement of small business in America, Making It is being brought to you by Comerica Bank. We listen, we understand, we make it work. By Honda, the power of dreams. And by Sempra Energy, a Fortune 500 energy services company committed to building a diverse supplier base.
Welcome back to Making It. Marketing is integral to the success of a new business. Yet many entrepreneurs don't understand how to market well. In fact, a whopping 60% of all new business ventures fail because of ineffective marketing. Today, you're meeting entrepreneurs who've avoided that pitfall. They've developed creative marketing techniques to build their companies.
Take Doug Lopez. Doug has been in construction all of his life. He spent 20 years working with window manufacturers and distributing their products. When the internet became a viable business tool, a manufacturer urged him to start a website. Well, Doug took that message even further. Instead of starting just a promotional website, he created a full-fledged business called First Windows.
Doug wanted First Windows to offer one-stop window shopping for customers, architects, and contractors. It allows them to compare manufacturing pricing, window design variables, and order online all at the same time. This idea was crystal clear, but getting started couldn't have been murkier.
Doug had to spend countless hours with software programmers to develop a system that could manage the complicated inventory and orders. And then he had to come up with hundreds of thousands of dollars to fund and promote his company. That's difficult in any business climate, but he was trying to fund a dot-com right in the middle of the dot-com bust.
And it didn't help that Doug's colleagues thought he was crazy, and they told him so every chance they got. Every other window retailer wasted no time telling him his vision simply couldn't be achieved. But thanks to an intelligent product mix and persistent marketing, Doug proved them all wrong.
I'm the first one in, and I'm the last one usually to leave. You cannot ask your people to work hard if you're not working hard yourself. You have to let them know that, you know, as a leader, you're there. And you're behind them. And I think that's something that's not done enough today. The boss wants to leave early. In my opinion, being self-employed, you have to work more than the next person.
Doug Lopez is the founder and CEO of FirstWindows.com, a company that's revolutionizing the way windows are sold.
Well, what First Windows does is we sell windows, quality vinyl windows and wood windows, on the internet. One of the only companies doing it. We have this proprietary software that allows us to do it. And so people can shop at home in their own house in their slippers and price their windows and save a lot of money.
A novel idea. Yet pricing a window online isn't as simple as it might sound. First Windows software computes over a billion variables in just seconds. So for the consumer, it's a breeze.
When they become a member of the site, they get a nice feature called comparison pricing. At that point, they can hit the comparison pricing button, and it'll give them the price for that same brand in all other brands. So the same measurements, the same options, and at the snap of a finger, it'll give them five other prices for the other local brands.
To develop the software, programmers were offered shares in lieu of a salary. And to raise capital, Doug set up private auctions for family and friends.
When you take money from friends and family, you better be ready to work. You can't just walk away from it. You can't shut it off. They put their trust and their money behind me, and I have to make it go pay off.
However, it would only take 4 months for First Windows to become profitable.
First Windows is Doug. Paul, our warehouse in regards to the amount of business we do is very small. We're efficient about moving material. 98% of it does not come to our warehouse. It gets drop shipped, which is unusual in the industry. Most distributors want to have it delivered to themselves and then take and deliver it to the customer. There's no sense in handling the material twice. We'd rather pay the manufacturer fee and have it drop shipped than handle the material. So we move thousands and thousands and thousands of pounds of material with never seeing it.
When other retailers started losing business to Doug's company, they demanded that the window manufacturers shut him down.
Well, I felt like somebody hit me in the stomach. I felt terrible here. I had taken people's money. And for all I knew, I was going to be forced out of business for really not doing anything wrong, just being entrepreneurial. It was one of the most terrible things I went through, was sitting in my car one day, knowing everybody was calling in on me, and they hated me. They hated what I did. I changed the industry.
And First Windows continues to make changes to their software. In a marketing coup, the company's program was integrated into the architect's computer-assisted design software.
The first thing a customer is going to see when he gets his plans from his architect, scrolls through his plans to get his window schedule, is us. It's the first time that a distributor is actually marketing himself on the plans. It says firstwindows.com. It gives the manufacturer's name, but it gives our phone number, and it gives the price that we can give you for that particular manufacturer.
First Windows is gearing up to give away 800,000 pieces of architectural software valued at $500 a program.
When you have, let's say, 800,000 pieces of software, each architect draws 4 to 5 plans a year. Well, now you're going to have several million people out there with your ad, with you on the plans, with your price. That business will come back to us.
Growth for First Windows has been impressive. After initially raising under $500,000 in 2000, First Windows is projected to do $5 million in 2005. But money's not the most important thing for this entrepreneur.
How I'd like to be remembered is just the guy that helped everybody out, made their life a lot easier. I'd like to thank the guy who did spell check for me, because it's really made my life easy.
The guy who did spell check for me.
It's the little people and the big people and all the people. Boy. Doug plans to grow First Windows into other construction supply arenas. Ultimately, he'd like to supply 70% of the materials needed for construction, including lumber, carpeting, roofing, and piping.
And coming up next, sometimes it pays to get a little help when it comes to marketing. Now, we're not talking about a consultant, but instead a well-known face and name to promote your business. No one knows that better than John Bellamy, who recently launched George Foreman's Knockout Cleaning Products. And he's in the studio to talk about celebrity endorsements and a lot more. But first, watch your screen for information on getting 301 proven creative marketing strategies.
Okay, here's how you can get in touch with the entrepreneurs you've met on today's show. You can contact Alvin Chang and Bobby Burton of Porterhouse Bistro at 310-659-1099. And you can reach Doug Lopez of First Windows by logging onto his website, which is firstwindows.com. Now, here's Lynette Romero with today's studio guest, John Bellamy.
Thanks, Emmett. John Bellamy is chairman and CEO of the Knockout Group, which recently launched George Foreman's Knockout Cleaning Products for household use. And he's here to talk about his company and how they have used creative marketing for a fast and profitable product launch, and how you can also do the same. So welcome to Making It. We appreciate
you
being here.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
Now, you realized a long time ago that using a celebrity to help you market your product can be very effective. Can you talk about that?
Absolutely. Years ago, I was Dick Gregory's business manager and helped him launch a series of products. And this time, it's George Foreman. When you have a major celebrity involved in a product launch, you have access to media that you would not have to spend money for. When you think about George going on Jay Leno, on Conan O'Brien, mm-hmm. getting on morning talk shows, getting front page newspapers and magazines, from a small company launching itself, you save multi-millions of dollars in having that happen. So having a celebrity is a really interesting piece of a unique marketing activity.
Now, you believe that you have some new technology with your products. How do you know if you've got a really good product?
Well, what we've done basically is done a lot of research, okay, on the product, and anyone that thinks that they have a good product should do focus groups. Mm-hmm. They should do qualitative and quantitative studies like we've done to determine if in fact the market is going to accept it, accept that product. After we did so, we determined that our product was so unique, so totally different, that there was no way with a celebrity attached to it and the right marketing involved, that we should fail.
What have you found is the best way to introduce a new product to the public to really educate them and get them on board?
Usually, from our perspective, it's doing infomercials. We're doing long form, meaning half-hour infomercials, two-minute infomercials. We're doing a lot of radio advertising. We're doing FSIs, or what's called couponing. We just put 24 million coupons in Sunday newspapers across the country.
I love that. You gotta love those coupons.
Exactly. A variety of ways in order to make the public know that the product actually exists. We also do a lot of in-store activity.
You know, there have been cleaning products that have been out there forever. You know, your mother's used it, your grandma's used that certain product, that's why you use it. How do you compete with that?
Well, basically having a unique technology, you know, like we have, is the real key in doing so. And in order to show you
what's so great about your product?
The difference in ours, I don't think anyone, this is a window cleaning product, normal ammonia-based window cleaners, you would not do this to your clothes.
No.
Nor would you do this.
Right,
completely,
in your mouth.
Completely safe, and it will not harm your plants, your children,
yeah,
the
your baby gets a hold of
pets,
it.
None whatsoever.
What does it taste like?
It tastes like soap.
So you really don't advise, this is not what you should do, but
do
if you do it, it's okay.
If you do it, if a child accidentally drinks the product,
right,
it will have no effect on them whatsoever.
Good demonstration. Okay, now once you've developed a new product or an invention, the next step is to get that patent. We hear about that. How do you go about that process?
What we did, there's a unique process that we employ. There's a company that we found that actually has something called a spore patenting process to go out and find everything that's going on around that whole industry. Mm-hmm. And once we did that, we actually employed that particular firm to file three patents for the product initially. There are six others that are going on right now, but you have to do research to assure that product is unique.
Okay, I have to ask you, does George use these products?
Absolutely. George and all 10 of his Georges.
And all 10 of his Georges exactly. use the
all
product.
All of them use the product, absolutely.
All right. I feel like I really need to get you a glass of water, so we're going to do that.
I'm fine.
Okay, we're going to tell you how you can get in touch with John Bellamy of the Knockout Group right after this break, so stay with us. You sure?
Absolutely.
You don't want me to do that.
In praise of the entrepreneurial spirit, Making It is being brought to you by Southern California Edison. For over 100 years, life powered by Edison. By the Disneyland Resort, you're invited to the happiest homecoming on Earth. And by the Boeing Company.
And if you'd like to contact John Bellamy of the Knockout Group, you can email him at johnb@knockoutcleaning.com.
And if you have a small business question you'd like answered, or you want to share a business lesson you've learned, check out the Entrepreneurs Forum on our website at makingittv.com. And there, you can also purchase a copy of today's show and tap into a number of business resources.
And that's all the time we have. Thank you for joining us. I'm Lynette Romero.
And I'm Emmett Miller. Thanks for joining us. See you next time right here on Making It.
We do, if someone does us a real good job, we will award them shares as a bonus. They don't know it's coming, just that here you go, here's some shares, thank you, you performed well. But it's also important to them to have some shares that they have a vested interest on the company.
What determines the worth of a man? His income, social status, level of education? Or is it his own ability to rise above the most dire of circumstances to make a good name for himself in this world? Looking forward to getting up in the morning and conquering the day to hold his head up high. Well, I'm Nelson Davis, executive producer of Making It. And on today's show, we'll meet an extraordinary individual, a man who went from being an illiterate convict to millionaire business owner. How could someone sink so low, then rise so high? It's a fascinating story, which we invite you to watch right now on Making It.
Making It, featuring inspiring personal stories of struggle, triumph, and success from America's small business communities.
Hello and welcome to Making It. I'm Lynette Romero.
And I'm Evan Miller. Thanks for joining us.
We're about to tell you one of the more riveting stories we've ever told here on Making It. It's the story of a little boy growing up impoverished. His father was in prison for attempted murder, and his mother was so strung out on drugs that he never even knew who she was until he was 11 years old. His days were spent struggling just to find enough to eat and a roof over his head.
Yes, life for John L. Langerston was about as rough as it gets. And if you think this takes place in a third world country, think again. His life began right here in the U.S., on the streets of Oakland, California. After being shuffled from one relative to another, from one home to another, he finally started school in the sixth grade. But now he had another problem. He'd never learned to read.
Well, if you think someone like John L. Langerston is destined to wind up in prison, you're right. But if you think that's the end of this story, that's the wrong presumption, because this formerly illiterate convict who was thrown away found redemption by his own force of will. And he now owns a multi-million dollar company. Xiomara Galindo takes us deeper into the story of a man who transformed his life.
We start off going from concept to reality. We do design, we do printing. We do CD manufacturing. We do urban marketing and production, which is the bus benches, the banners, the vehicle wraps. And as well, we do EPKs, which is electronic press kits for independents. And now recently, we joined ventures with Dexter Brown Photography, which is a famous photographer. So we can also capture the images before we design them.
Where can we see your designs?
Almost everywhere. No, just the stores throughout the, you know, throughout each state. The bus benches is in California. We control the bus benches, a large portion of the urban bus benches in the urban communities. When you see the hip-hop stuff out there, a lot of times that was us.
Most of the entrepreneurs that we've highlighted here on Making It have had some sort of a challenge that they've had to overcome. Yours carried through from childhood to young adult life. Tell us about those troubles.
My childhood is very simple. You know, just like most children that grew up in an urban community, the difference was me, my mom is white, my dad is black. I grew up in a time and era when that wasn't really proper, during the Huey Newton era in the 60s. I don't want to tell my age, but at that time, I just had to go through maybe 9 different elementary schools, if I'm not correct, before I even had a chance to meet my mom and find out she was white. And it kind of, you know, left me behind in catching on to the basic things of life, reading, writing, things that you really have to learn at that age. And so at that point, I just got disconnected from the educational profile of life.
By his teenage years, John L. became interested in running track. He did so well that he earned a college scholarship, but an injury ended both his sports and college careers and landed him back on the streets of Oakland, California. There he turned to a life of drugs and crime and ultimately became known as a drug kingpin.
Selling drugs, I'm not highlighting that. I really thank God for changing my spirit to the way it is today. But you have to admire the traditional state of mind of any traditional drug dealer on this planet from an urban perspective as someone from a business. The willingness to work under long hours, under demanding conditions, salesmanship, supply and demand. I mean, these things are the same attributes that any traditional businessman must have in order to succeed as a businessman.
John L. was arrested in 1987 and served a decade of his life in prison.
People don't realize you do 10 years in prison as a first-time offender. It's like, whoa. I spent 4 of that 10 years in the hole. One in particular time, I spent a year straight. In that time, I had to come into understanding myself as a human on this planet. And when I say that, I mean the spirit in which I perceive myself as being as a man. Learning how to read and write was so important to me that I started learning one word a day just to catch on to the simple words, the, at, off, things that you think I automatically know. So in the process of understanding this time, I had to humble myself and find myself.
After John L. was released from prison, he started working with some friends doing marketing for the entertainment industry.
Thomas and Tracy Underwood are two business partners of mine in the Bay Area. We had a company called Funky Fat Graphics. At the time, Thomas and Tracy had become very popular at creating a lot of the images, like for the Masterpiece, the E-40s, and establishing themselves. Well, my goal when I came home from prison was to figure out what can I do to get in that niche.
Jonell came up with the idea to put hip-hop ads on bus benches.
It was a time when the outdoor advertisement had kind of fell at a slope because of the tobacco industry. You couldn't no longer advertise outside. You didn't see hip-hop on bus benches. So I located the people who started the whole theme of the bus benches and look, these benches is empty. Let me work with them. And they kind of laughed at me because hip-hop was hip-hop. And I'm like, well, hey, you know what, I tell you what. If that's the case, if I do this deal, you know, let me control the ones in the urban communities. And they was like, okay. So Master P and E-40 really made it possible for me to be able to do that.
How did you end up here at this place on Main Street?
In the Bay Area, I have become very popular at being in the position to design and print and produce a lot of the stuff that you've seen in the urban communities. So I felt that I could come to Los Angeles as a so-called, you know, one who can establish one's image and really establish my presence there. I was on parole, I picked up, got a 90-day pass, and drove to Los Angeles in an old car, and I just really drove around everywhere. One day in my car, I drove 8 tanks of gas out, just driving, looking. And then I spotted this particular paste, and I was like, hold up, I gotta have that. And I went from there.
Tell me about your first project.
I had a small place, and my first client that came in, I had one little computer. And he was like, man, L, you gonna be able to do this? I say, man, I can do it. He said, well, I believe you. I'm gonna hook you up with this guy. And this gentleman happened to be on vacation with me as well. He brought in Barry Hankerson and them crew, which gave me the movie soundtrack to Romeo Must Die. And I had a chance to produce a large portion of the product that went out on that particular project, and it made a name for myself.
Boy, talking about threadbare starts.
And this is just the beginning of the story. Mm. There's more to come. Of the 2 million inmates who will be released from U.S. prisons this year, statistics tell us that 60 to 80% of them will return within just a couple of years. How Jonell avoided that trap by focusing on his business, we'll tell you about that coming up later in the show.
While Jonell was in the hole, he began to set his goals that would turn his life around. In Secrets of Success, best-selling author Jack Canfield says, that's how you program your unconscious mind and you keep yourself focused.
If you want to be more successful in life, you have to start setting goals. Research shows that only 3% of Americans ever set goals at the beginning of the year. And it's those same 3% who are running the economy, who are the leaders of our business and the top salespeople. Without goals, you end up getting used by and working for people who have them. And so each year you want to take at the beginning of the year some time and make a list of all the goals that you want to achieve in that year. And then even if you just put them in a drawer and never looked at them, research says you'll actually achieve more. But more importantly, if you will read that list of goals every day, just one time, it begins to program your unconscious, keeps you focused, and you start having creative ideas and start noticing all the things in the world that can help you achieve your goals. So make sure that you make a list of everything you want to achieve and make it measurable and specific. It's not enough to say, I want a house on the ocean. Say, I will own a 4,000 square foot house on Pacific Coast Highway in Malibu by January 1st, 2007. And if you'll do that with every goal and review those every day, you'll be surprised at what starts happening in your life.
Okay, only 500,000 square foot. Jack Canfield's the author of the best-selling Chicken Soup for the Soul series. His latest book is entitled The Success Principles. To learn more about it, you can log on to his website at successprinciples.com. And for more secrets of success, log on to our website at makingit.com.
And coming up next, how Jonell Langerston is using his life lessons and thriving business to steer young people onto the right path. We'll have more on this remarkable entrepreneur when we return.
Supporting the small business community in America, Making It is being brought to you by Honda, the power of dreams. By Comerica Bank, we listen, we understand, we make it work. And by Southern California Edison, for over 100 years, life powered by Edison.
And welcome back to Making It. On today's show, we're taking a look at the life of Jonell Langerston, a man who went from drug kingpin to convicted felon to hip-hop marketing mastermind.
When Jonnell went to prison, he was barely able to read, and he wasn't alone. The New Jersey Department of Corrections reports that 70% of its inmates are functioning at the lowest literacy levels. Yet only 2% of the prison budget is spent on educating inmates.
And consequently, when many of them are released, they don't have any skills that translate well into the corporate world. Almost no one will hire them. But interestingly enough, the transition from successful criminal to successful entrepreneur draws upon some shared principles.
Jonnell was lucky to catch a break from friends in the hip-hop marketing business. It's an explosive industry. Hip-hop music accounted for 25% of U.S. record sales in 2003, topping the $3 billion mark.
Ziamaro Galindo has the story, Jonnell's story, the continuation of how he explains that what he picked up on the streets became the key to the success of Fat FX.
Jonnell, give me a description of your business in the early days when you were working out of a one-room facility.
When you first start a company, a lot of times you can't afford to buy a lot of stuff, so you have to buy what you can. iMac at the time came out with a good rate as well as the G4s, and then, of course, I had one press. So, you know, I couldn't really afford to do a lot, and if you can't afford to pay people the hours that it take to keep a job going, you'd find yourself there 24/7 and trying to make sure you accomplish your goals.
What has been the greatest lesson in growing your business?
It's interesting. I think the greatest lesson for me is being able to live up to every obligation that I commit to. Every time I say I'm gonna do something, I do it. That way it don't never have a question. I'm an urban dude. I don't speak the corporate language, so I have no choice but to prove in action.
You have several clients in the music industry. How did you establish those relationships?
It's almost like coming through the back door, the mailroom routine. The streets demand a certain look. If your product is not already looking like the stuff I filtered to the street from an urban perspective for independence, then it'll get thrown away. So now it forced other individuals who are on the street teams passing that product out to say, wait a minute, this fire don't look as good as this. We need to call whoever doing this. So I come from the back door up, and then my pricing be to the point where, wait a minute, you sure it costs just that much? So it's way cheaper, way more effective, much more, you know, vibrant in colors. And so what can they do? They have to start looking. And voila, one step at a time.
Your journey in the business world continues. Tell us where Fat FX is today in regards to gross income.
I mean, I'm a millionaire, you know what I mean? What can I say? I don't think it's good to pop your collar on that. I think that at this point, I come from something that wasn't, you know, what it is today, and I thank God for my blessings. I have much more of an influence over my urban community now because of the fact that I've been blessed to achieve the goals that I have. When I go out to talk to them and discuss things that can change their life, they're willing to listen now, and that's what means something to me.
Where do you rate as far as similar businesses, and how do you stay ahead of the competition?
A lot of the great, you know, millionaires on this planet today always said you have to diversify, step into new areas and new things. So what I've done is, again, I started with design, went from design to doing printing, from printing to doing, you know, CD manufacturing, from CD manufacturing to vehicle wraps, from vehicle wraps into bus bench advertising, from bus bench advertising to electronic press kits. And even our electronic press kits now has progressed into, you know, each time I look for a way to fulfill the niche of the market in each area, and it helps me continue to grow.
Do you have any plans to start other businesses?
Yeah, I have an idea about doing like an Urban Born. You know, Urban Born is like a company that I like working with kids. I go in, I have a unique way of educating kids on how not to follow the path. Since we've been fortunate enough to do a large portion of the hip-hop stuff, we use that as tools. We have the artists come in, sign posters, flyers, stickers, and et cetera, to pass out to the actual kids in the schools as if they paid attention, and I'd ask a question. If they got the question right, they'd get a prize. And my goal is to do that really a lot more. I feel at ease in that moment because kids really can identify with my soul.
Unfortunately, many kids seem to get lost along the way. What advice do you have for them?
I don't believe the youngsters today get lost. Unfortunately, corporate America think that they're lost because they're surviving in an environment that they have to be who they are in order to walk down that block. And in their state of mind, they're not lost. They're actually right there in what's happening. But I do also know that tomorrow morning, they can wake up and be different. They can wake up tomorrow morning with a bullet in them and they'll never want to walk that way again. They can wake up tomorrow morning and have cancer and never want to be that way again. A young kid can wake up tomorrow morning and be pregnant and she'd never want to act. You understand what I'm saying? Don't wait until some tragedy happened to wake up and be different. Those kids are not lost. They just need a reason to wake up tomorrow morning and be different.
As someone who has truly turned his life around, what tools do you think a person needs to be able to make it?
Tools is so important. Learn how to learn, period. Sixth, seventh, and eighth grade, at that point, just learn how to learn. That way, you understand that you do need to learn. At what level of intensity you learn at is what you get out of life.
Many people find it very difficult to adjust to life after being outside of prison. How were you able to succeed?
I like what life has to offer. You know, I love watching people smile. I love the attitude that one gives when you smile at them. And just the whole feeling of life and just the inspiration of it. Some of the brothers is coming home without that feeling because they already losing a major ingredient. No education. No real workman skills. What are they gonna, they don't even know how to talk corporate language. So the only jobs available to them are remedial jobs. And unfortunately, they're not gonna go and stand up tall as a soldier on this planet and work at McDonald's. It's just they're not gonna do that. You have to give them something they can identify with. That's why music is so relieving.
How do you feel living in this unbelievable home when you had such humble beginnings?
I'm not comfortable. I'm very grateful for what God has given me, but every day I'm right there dealing with people. I don't need no jewelry, no fancy cars. I got all the old cars though, but still, you know, I feel like there's a gap missing. And so I look every morning and I thank God and I look at that image and I say, wow, I still got a long ways to go, even though we've traveled a long ways.
He's captivating.
He really is, yeah.
And so good to see him out there with the kids. They're looking at him. You can see they're looking at him, and he can communicate and really catch their attention.
And he understands them, and I think that they feel that, you know.
They're looking up to him.
And, you know, some of his more famous clients include Beyonce, Nas, Mariah Carey. He continues to diversify his business as well. And you know what? He's also reconnected with both his parents, and finally they have a good relationship.
Wow. Well, coming up next, we'll tell you how you can contact John L. And our studio guest is Dr. Tom Bay. He'll tell us what traits all winners share and how we can change our lives by what we think. Don't go away.
Okay, here's how you can get in touch with the entrepreneur you've met on today's show. You can contact John L. Langerston at FatFX. Their phone number is 323-276-5060 or log on to his website at fatfx.com. And now here's Lynette with today's studio guest, Dr. Tom Bay.
Thanks, Emmett. Dr. Tom Bay is the author of several books, including his latest, Change Your Attitude. The book explains how you can create your own success one thought at a time. He's also a highly sought-out motivational speaker employed by corporate giants such as AT&T, Marriott, Qualcomm, and Sony. Welcome to Making It. We appreciate
you being
here.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Now, first of all, let's say the name of your book again. The title is Change Your Attitude, Creating Success One Thought at a Time. So you say changing your attitude can really change your life. How so?
Absolutely. It's a reflection of who you are. And even at times when you think you may be hiding it, those around you can pick up on it immediately. So if you're giving off a positive attitude and you really do feel it, it shows. If you're pretending it's positive and it really isn't, it shows as well.
You just can't act.
Yeah.
it just doesn't work. It's hard to hold that act the whole time.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
When we talk about having a good attitude as being really important in business, how can a person assess their attitude and find out if it's working for them?
It's real easy. First of all, you've got to take responsibility, and in doing that, you have to look at yourself. And if you find yourself consistently blaming others, finding that it's not really your responsibility. We live, for instance, I feel very strongly about this, in a victim society today. Mm-hmm. We have a tendency to find that everything's going wrong, including my attitude, is someone else's fault. Mm-hmm. Students will say, well, it's my teacher's fault, it's my professor's fault, it's my spouse's fault, it's my kids, it's my boss. And what it really boils down to, it's a reflection of who you are inside.
Right. But you have to be honest with yourself.
Absolutely.
About it.
Absolutely.
You talk about having a right attitude and a wrong attitude.
Right.
Can you give me examples of both?
Well, the right attitude, you've hit one of them. Right attitude is, first of all, taking responsibility, being involved with your life and showing some integrity about it. Mm-hmm. Setting goals is real important. Being honest with yourself, as you had mentioned, is real important. And also being aware of the fact you've got to dedicate some time to yourself to keep that positive attitude. We have 1,440 minutes a day. That's all we have. That's everything we're ever going to have. Mm-hmm. And it's 1440, no matter how you slice it, pack it, dice it, it's still 1440 minutes.
Can you give us some very specific steps to develop the right attitude? You may really want to do it, but, you know, are you doing it right? How do you do that?
First of all, it's important to set down ideas on paper, thinking about them and what have you. Some of the things that people don't do is take some time to soul search. One of the perfect times to do it is we have a tendency when we get into a vehicle, it's almost habit. We reach to turn on the radio or the CD.
Mm-hmm. Or I talk always, on the phone.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And you know, or get a fax or whatever it is today we can do in our car.
Right.
But I say, just give yourself, because you're so important, give yourself 1 minute of nothing. Don't turn the radio on. Consciously think, I'm going to just focus on myself for a bit. Mm-hmm. In many cases, you know what you'll find out, Lynette? You'll drive 50 miles and not realize you've never turned it on because the conversation is so interesting.
Right.
And you start assessing some things about your life and what you need to be doing with it and where you'd like to go.
You start out with a minute, but you really need more than that.
Absolutely. Yeah. But start with a minute.
Can you give us some more examples on some tips to set clear goals and stick to them? We heard somebody say about writing them down every day, telling yourself every day. You agree with that?
Yeah, Jack had mentioned that. That is so vital because we are so busy today. The goals need to be written down. And oftentimes what I will tell individuals that I've worked with, not only do you write it down in your planner or paper that you carry around with you on the day of, as part of your task, make sure you have some steps to make sure you meet your goals. Another thing you can do is put it on a sticky note and put it on the mirror. When you're getting shaving in the morning, putting on makeup, there's a reflection there that you can read that note to remind yourself, I have these goals for today or for this week.
Right.
So you stay focused.
And when you don't meet those goals?
When you don't meet those goals, guess who you're looking at in the mirror? It's back to reassessing again. What do I need to do differently? What haven't I done that I said I was going to do?
Right.
What did I overlook?
You're in control of your destiny.
Exactly.
Thank you so much. Great tips. Thank you, Tom. We'll tell you how you can contact Dr. Tom Bay right after this break, so stick around.
The entrepreneurial spirit is alive and well at Making It, which is being brought to you by the Disneyland Resort. You're invited to the happiest homecoming on Earth. By the Boeing Company. And by Sempra Energy, a Fortune 500 energy services company committed to building a diverse supplier base.
And you can reach Tom Bay at 888-440-8000 or log on to his website at tombay.com.
And if you'd like to get a copy of today's show or to find other small business resources, just log on to our website at makingittv.com.
And I think we'd both agree that the theme of the show today was transformational abilities. It doesn't matter where you're starting from, what the tools were that you were giving, it's what you're doing with those tools right now to make it what you want it to be.
Another thing Dr. Tom Bay said is, it's your life. What are you going to do about it?
You
know,
there you go.
It's true. It is so true. What are you going to do about it?
Take a nap. That's our show for this week. I'm Emmett Miller.
And I'm Lynette Romero. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time right here on Making It.
You youngsters out there, stay focused. Every day you can make a difference if you step forward, one step at a time. Each step I've made, I had to prove it. I don't speak the corporate language. I don't have the corporate look. I never allowed that to be the reason I didn't get the corporate dollar.